William Ortgessen was born on June 11, 1924, in Petersburg, Illinois. He was a Jeep driver in the Army, ranked as a PFC. Right after high school, he was drafted on June 4, 1943, to serve in France and Germany. He went to waterproofing school to learn how to waterproof the tanks and vehicles. He landed in Europe on D-5 on his 20th birthday and was a part of the 44th Ordnance Evacuation Company.
Our job was to go out and pick up knocked out tanks and dig them out. And a lieutenant and I would go out every morning. We'd either have instruction where they were, or we'd go out and look for them every morning. And then we'd go ahead that night and take our big transport trucks out to pick up these tanks that were knocked out. And we were constantly in no man's land.
His specific job in the unit was a Jeep driver.
Being a Jeep driver, I was on the road out every day doing something, which I was young. I was only, like I said, 20 years old. They called me junior because I was so young and little. And like I said, my job was, I was a messenger, but yet I went out and recon Jeeps every day, see where they were. I laid these big trucks out at night to pick up the tanks in no man's land. And then one night we was coming back. The roads over there weren't very wide. But when you got a little Jeep and you got those big trucks behind you and you're meeting the tank convoy coming to you, you kind of hesitate what's going on. Didn't know where to go because those big tanks are coming at us. They were their own tanks, but they was going up to the front, and we was going back to the other way. Mm-hmm. And it was a little tricky.
While serving in England, he ran into a friend from Petersburg.
When in England, I was a Jeep driver there too. I took some men to the dentist. And who walked in the dentist but Bill Shaw? They run the Observer in Petersburg. Bill Shaw was my next door neighbor. Talk about a small world, all that far away, and he was there at Bristol, England.
While stationed north of St. Lo, he rescued an American pilot.
The lieutenant and I was out patrolling for tanks, and we heard this shooting going on overhead, and our American pilot had to bail out of his plane. So we ventured on to try to catch him because he was on the front line and we didn't know whether he was going to land on our area or the other area. Well, we got to him and the French had already got to him for us and they wanted a parachute, but we finally got him and we took him back to headquarters. And that was one of the things that our job was to do this and pick up tanks.
His job constantly placed him in no man's land, which put the troops at risk of fire. But he did not encounter fighting until the Battle of the Bulge. There were several events that he participated in leading up to the battle.
When the Battle of the Bulge came loose, an infantry outfit of St. Vith had sent their men back to Paris for R&R. So they sent me, being a Jeep driver and messenger, over to St. Vith from Edinburgh, where we were stationed, to be their messenger. So the bell of the Bulge was breaking loose that evening. And so the next morning they sent me to Luxembourg City, the headquarters, to get their instructions. The Germans had been building up and Americans, we'd just been sitting around not realizing they're doing it. Well, this one evening or one afternoon, the bombing started. That's when they sent me to up to St. Vith, be the messenger because the infantry people were already back in Paris having a rest. But the Germans had been building up this for quite a while, and so when they came in a big surge. But what they did, they failed to have their fuel supplies follow along with the men, like we was having the same trouble. keeping the gas to the trucks. And so they got up to where they had run out of fuel, hoping to get the American fuel dump, but the Americans destroyed their own fuel dumps that we had accumulated, so the Germans had to slow down. And like I say, the weather was such that there was no airplane flying. It was just all foggy, cold, miserable, just bad weather.
He came in contact with German forces when the Germans started shelling the road he was driving on.
I was driving down the road gently early in the morning. I heard shells going off. Pretty soon I was in up the ditch. Me and my Jeep was in the ditch with the broken front wheel. A shell had went off next to us and blew it off the road. I cannot exactly remember the explosion, but it did my mind or knocked me out or something, because I just cannot recall being blown off the road, but I knew it was because I was sitting over in a ditch on the wrong side of the road.
After he was blown off the road, he traveled to various places and faced more problems with the Germans.
So then in the meantime, then I went ahead and got the wheel back on, and our company with Edinburgh was between where we were and Luxembourg City, so I in turn stopped by our company and got another wheel for my Jeep, because I was going to be running messages, I had to be able to go. Yeah. So then, in the meantime, I got into Luxembourg City, and I went to the headquarters, and as soon as I got in the door, a man came yelling in behind me, "Move out, the Germans are coming." So I in turn drove out of the, went in my Jeep and drove on to Bastogne, and then I was going over to to St. Vith where I was, but I got up to Hoof Lodge, and they said that road's already been taken, you can't, St. Vith's already been taken. And that's what upset me, because I had taken all my stuff plus my Christmas cookies from my Aunt Frieda's Christmas cookies with me. And here those Germans are going to get to eat my Aunt Frieda's Christmas cookies, which didn't sit too good. So anyway, I couldn't get on St. Vith to get my Christmas cookies. So I had, there were four or five fellows there, and I said, well, I'm going back to Bastogne. My company be coming up out of Edinburgh up through Bastogne. So I in turn then went, and the three guys got with me. We went into Bastogne, and we got into Bastogne. I seen one of our trucks are coming, 44th Ordnance Evac. So I followed it into a town up the road, and we got up there. And after we got up there, we went to a big old schoolhouse where they had pot metal stoves that warmed your cleft. Well, I was all wet and cold, so I took my clothes off, and I had a fellow by the name of Edward Pike from Petersburg who was in the same company. So I started wearing his clothes. My officer that I drove said, "Junior, we got to go back to Bastogne." So him and I loaded up. I dropped my windshield again and made sure my 30 caliber worked, because we were going back in the territory then where it's going to be rough maybe. So we got back to Bastogne and pulled into the shed with the four or five other Jeep drivers and officers. They're all sitting in there, finding out which way to go. And then sat there, and just about daylight they came through and said that the Germans had just taken the road that you could get out on. Well, so we sat there, what we're going to do then? So I guess we'll settle in and fight from in here. But then a little bit later they came through, they had retaken the road. So then we got back out of there, and after that then we went on and patrolled. In the meantime, Patton's army had moved into our territory, so we were transferred to Patton's army to pick up his tanks. And so in turn, we was in that area there, and we picked up his tanks and hauled them back for repair.
As the Battle of the Bulge continued, he was surrounded by the Germans in Bastogne, but the next morning he was able to leave.
These Americans, they stayed in this pocket and wouldn't move out. And like I said, we was in it for a few hours. We were in the pocket, couldn't get out, but we did. And Germans finally had to give up because they couldn't get any farther because they couldn't get their fuel either. They was running out of fuel and everything, food.
While serving in the war, he never had a complaint about his food. He and his comrades always enjoyed getting French food on their leave in Paris. He also had many experiences with acquiring different food.
We enjoyed whenever we got some French food we'd get. Otherwise, I happened to have, there happened to be three or four farmers in our group and hunters. Well, when we was up around the end in the forest, we went out deer hunting. So we had deer meat. And things like that. And story starts off, I got some pictures there. When we first landed, we weren't this in between these hedgerows, which weren't very big areas. And next door, there's a milk cow. And it seemed like some of the fellows in our outfit knew how to milk a cow. So first thing every morning, they get out and they'd milk the cow before the lady was there. And we'd get fresh milk every morning. But then at night she'd get her milk because we wouldn't go out and swipe it at night. But we did get fresh milk from this milk cow every morning because the cow was right next door, hedgerows right next door. He didn't have to go very far to get to it. As far as food, I could never, like I said, maybe I wasn't picky, but I just happy with what I was doing. We had a job to do over there, and we went and did it. And I don't think anybody really complained about much of anything. I mean, you went day and night and night and day without any sleep sometimes, and not any clean clothes. And like I said, during the Badge Bulge, I went 3 days. There was a just same clothes on and no wash or anything. Just go. I mean, that was a job you had to do.
All throughout the war, he kept a good luck charm with him.
I had a little Bible that my Aunt Frieda and Aunt Ann had gave me, a little tiny one. And that thing of it, I even had it during the Battle of the Bulge. And when they got my Aunt Frieda's cookies, Christmas cookies, I still had my little Bible. And so I guess you'd have to say that could have been part of my good luck charm.
He felt that everyone's job was essential to help win the war.
You had a job you were doing over there, getting the war over and fighting and doing your job of picking up tanks or whatever. Whoever was over there, if you're a paramedic or what, you had your job to do and you didn't let anything, I guess, distract you from what you're doing.
After a year and a half of serving in the war, he was discharged on December 12, 1945. He departed from Marseille, France on a boat to New York City. From there, he took a train to a camp in the north. Edward Pike's son then picked him up and took him back home to Petersburg.
I came home then and married my sweetheart, high school sweetheart, after a year and a half.
Mr. Ortgessen did not keep in touch with many of the troops he met.
This is what upsets a person about this, just like the pilot that we rescued. We never got a name, we might have, but we didn't write it down. Have no idea who he was, or just the pilot that we helped take back to safety.
His experiences in the war taught him that helping other people is important. Therefore, he volunteered as a firefighter in Petersburg and got a job in the heating and cooling business.
We're here to help other people. And that's the reason, like I say, I've been on the volunteer fire department for 45 years.
We would like to thank Mr. William Ortgessen for taking his time to let us interview him and for letting us tell his story. He had a lot of interesting stories that we enjoyed listening to. Although Mr. Ortgessen felt that he was just doing his job and was in no way a hero, we have come to learn that even his role as a Jeep driver and a supply man behind the lines was a vital part of the war effort. Without the supplies that they provided, other troops would not have been as successful as they were.
This shows that every job of a soldier is important, no matter how small it may be.
Mr. Ordgessen also gave some valuable insight to what the everyday life was like for soldiers. We have concluded that most of the time when going off to fight in World War II, the schedule and our daily routine wasn't much different. Sometimes it might have even been better.
Most of the men that were fighting came out of the Great Depression and didn't have as much at home as they would have gotten during the war.
We have also come to appreciate the hard work and sacrifices made by the soldiers in all different capacities in the armed services. It is very humbling to think that when many of these men who were putting their lives at risk were only a few years older than we as high school students are now. The sacrifices that they have made have given us the freedom and the rights we have today.